I, Mrs. Madhupava, from IFSA headquarters, welcome you all on this auspicious day of Teachers' Day. I'm privileged to host this first GBL webinar at Vigyan Prasar. And to celebrate the Teachers' Day, my regular habit, I would like to dedicate a few lines to the teachers. Pranam mere adhyapak, pranam mere uddharak, janani aur janan se jyada aapka samman hai. Mera hona ittefaq ho sakta hai, lekin mera banna to aapki sadhana ka parinam hai. For all the teachers, those who are present here, and happy Teachers' Day once again. I would like to invite Dr. Lalita Dhareshwar, IFSA Vigyan Prasar Initiative and Chairperson of IFSA Golden Jubilee Celebration. So welcome all. Dr. Lalita, please.
Yeah, thank you, Madhu. Thank you for inviting me. And I'm really, really very, very happy to be in front of you to have this grand inauguration of this garden-based learning workshops in collaboration with Vigyan Prasar. And if you see, IFSA and Vigyan Prasar share the same kinds of objectives. That is to take the science to the masses and bring a scientific temper to society. And not only that, bring in IFSA, that is Indian Women Scientists Association, one of our main mandates is to promote the women who are in the scientific background and to strengthen and empower women through various programs like the one we are going to hold today, that is skill development program. And Vigyan Prasar is exactly doing this by meeting people who have this kind of temper and this kind of a vision to bring science to masses and improve the quality of life of the human beings on this earth. And we at IFSA, we have 11 branches through which we are able to reach out to thousands of people, not only in the urban areas, but we would like to spread the science and the spirit of science even to the rural masses. They already have the spirit. It is only that we are kind of guiding and kind of orienting them so that they can be skilled and they can learn some new things so that they can, kind of support their livelihoods through these various skill development programs. And in fact, when I came across the first lecture of Dr. Arvind Ranade a few months back, maybe 6 months back, on one of the platforms where I was attending a physics-based webinar, I was so impressed by the work that they are doing that I immediately wrote to him that we would like to associate and collaborate with you. And he was so good. And he and Mrs. Dr. Kinkini Dasgupta, who is also she is looking after our various projects in collaboration with Vigyan Prasar. Both of them have supported us. And Dr. Nidhi is here on behalf of Vigyan Prasar. And all of them have given us such a supporting hand that our projects are going on very well today. And we have three projects. One is four. In fact, one of them has two components, science nurture, which has got the each one, where a science, from college, science graduate, BSc or MSc student from a college, kind of handholds a school student and teaches the child, 8th standard child for a period of 3 to 4 months and to make their basics and fundamentals in science and maths very strong. And this concept was because we felt that right from the young age, the people of our country, people of the world, they have to understand how to, kind of reach out to those who need our help. And the education is the best way to kind of bring the people up in society. And our college students and the mentees and mentors both are enjoying this program and they are doing very well. The other one is what we have become members of the VIPnet Club of Vigyan Prasar, through which we are doing so many activities to make people aware and take science to the masses. by making demos and demo lectures and things like that. And we have what is known as a wonderful, now as Vijaya said, this garden-based learning workshop is part of the Living Plant Museum, which is a very kind of innovative idea put forward by our garden members, and to teach everything through a garden, a Living Plant Museum garden. And we have another program called Shikshan Setu, which is a beautiful program which reaches out to the rural masses, teachers who are teaching pre-primary and primary school teachers, because that is where the foundation of education is laid out. So through our ECCE, that is Early Childhood Care Education Program, which is affiliated to the SNDT University at IVSA, we have designed these modules and reaching out to hundreds of teachers across the country. And that is why it is called Shikshan Setu, because it's the bridge through which the knowledge and the education and the best practices flow from the trainers to the teachers. And this has been going on from the last few months. And today we are so excited, Dr. Jyoti Mava, to hear you. And there are so many women who are looking forward to this workshop. And with this, I will end my speech here, because so many of us have to give their views. So thank you, Madhu. Please take over.
Thank you, Lalita, for inspirational words and love all the time you spread. As scientist at Vigyan Prasad, Dr. Nidhi, over to you, please.
Thank you so much, Madhu ma'am. It was really an honor to be here in one of your workshops. Respected Dr. Alka Singh ma'am, professor and head Navsari Agriculture University, Gujarat, Dr. Jyoti Marwa ma'am from KLE College, Navi Mumbai, and Ms. Vidushi Sharma from the same college, the experts we have invited for today's workshop, Dr. Lalita ma'am, Dr. Vijaya ma'am, and Madhu ma'am, and all other designated members of IWSA, and the participants who have joined us for this session today. I welcome you all from the behalf of Vigyan Prasad as one of the collaborating members of this program. In the inaugural session of this garden-based learning workshop, the program is basically designed with the aim to empower the women of our nation. So one of its novel kind of workshop, we believe that we will be able to take the mandate of both the organization, whether it is IWSA or Vigyan Prasad, of taking science to the society and developing a nation which is scientifically aware. So all the best for all the participants. We have many more of these workshops lined up after this. So take a great experience from this workshop. And thank you so much for inviting me and taking this great initiative to the society. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Nidhi. You've been a big support all the time whenever we approached you. Thank you so much. Now, I would like to invite our chief guest for today's webinar to give a keynote address, Dr. Alka Singh, Professor and Head of Department of Floriculture. And Landscape Architecture at Navsari Agriculture University, Navsari, Gujarat. She's BSc Horticulture, Gold Medalist, MSc Horticulture, Faculty Topper from Gujarat Agricultural University, and PhD Horticulture from CCS University, Meerut, UP. As an Indo Research Fellow, she was associated with University of California, Davis, USA during the year 2009 and 10. She is recipient of Young Fellow Award 2006 by the Society of Recent Development in Agriculture. All India Best Publication Award 2017, the Society for Advancement of Human and Nature Young Scientist Award in 2018, IJTA Manmohan Avtar Gold Medal in Floriculture 2018 by the Horticulture Society of India, GAAS Research Award on Dry Flowers Technology 2019 besides various paper presentation awards in different seminars and symposiums at national level. Madam, she is in love with flowers from her childhood days and thus caters a passion of her subject. Her area of research involves protected cultivation, technology of flowers, ornamental plants, and their value addition. She has compiled and edited 16 books, compendiums, 15 books, chapters, 50 popular technical articles, and 60 research papers in national and international journals. She has guided 20 students as major guide for MSc and PhD degrees. She is actively involved in conducting trainings, organizing seminars, symposiums, workshops, and exhibitions on different aspects of horticulture at NAU, Navsari, and has delivered papers in different scientific meetings held in USA and Denmark. She is a nature lover, an admirer of arts, as well as believes in the strength of science and technology for the upliftment of humanity. We are privileged to have you, madam. I invite you to say, give a keynote for today's webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Alka Singh. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, Madhu ma'am. And thanks to Vijaya ma'am for connecting with me and inviting me in this session of webinar by IWSC. I'm very, very happy to know about the activities of Indian Women Scientist Association as well as Vigyan Prasar. And these things are also very close to me, garden, then skill development, and value addition in flowers. So I'm also very much connected with these things. And I feel very much attached to these aspects, you know, because they directly affect your life. And through these things, we can help in changing life of many people. Now, when we talk about flowers, today's topic is about roses, wherein value addition in roses for the health benefit. So I'm very much happy to know about this topic. And talking about in general about flowers, I'd like to show a brief presentation, ma'am. So I'll just share my screen. Madam, the screen is visible?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So talking about flowers for health and wellness, when we talk about flowers, like in general, when we ask people, like, what is the value of flower? They just go blank because it is, first thing is that comes to mind is the beauty. The moment you look at flowers, it gives just a wonderful joy. And you just get mesmerized just looking at the flowers. But what is the value behind it? So the flowers have a strong emotional and psychological impact, as well as in many ways, flowers are associated with the economical value. And that is how socially also they can contribute in many way in improving our social status. And that is the reason why flowers have been in cultivation for a long, long period of time. Otherwise, in fruits and vegetables, we have seen that only those varieties which are having good in taste or which are more appealing to people from health point of view, they are surviving. But flowers are contributing in many ways, which directly or indirectly are helping us in our life. And of course, in health, it is directly or indirectly very well connected. Now here, I would just like to show a haiku. Haiku is a small poem, just of 2 to 3 lines, and that is from Basho, that the temple bell stops, but I still hear the sound coming out of the flowers. So this is the beauty of flowers. Like when we go to temple and when the bell rings, for a moment, we come to a standstill. For a moment, we feel connected with the Almighty. But then as the bell stops, everything, we are again into that worldly life. But looking at flowers, it has a long lasting effect, because when we are just surrounded by flowers and greenery, somewhere we get stuck up and we forget our all worries, and we just feel at ease with nature and we feel at ease with life. Again, a small haiku. Politics aside, for a brief moment, cherry blossoms. This is by Terry French. So many things people, you know, keep thinking like what is going to happen, or some politics keeps going on. But then when we see a lot of just flowers blooming, like when the cherry blossoms, the whole atmosphere changes. So the moment comes where everything becomes joyful. And that's the beauty of flowers. And you all know, we have felt this kind of chaos everywhere, wherein environmental problems, they have just entered our home, our overall surroundings. Urban heat island is on rise. So much of concrete jungle we are being living with. And it's not just about outer environment, but of course, indoor environment also. Indoor air quality has been degrading. And as per the study from Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation, around 2.6 million people died prematurely in 2016. In indoor air environment, there are many things that contaminate air, be it paints, be it many volatile organic compounds, many products keep building, even cooking. So many things do contribute, and around more than 300 volatile organic compounds are known to influence the indoor air quality, and they turn out to be indoor contaminants. So here, the plants and flowers can rescue us from all this kind of chaos. So human psychology, it is affected by the color, texture, and fragrance, and all these things we find in flowers, right? So when you see the flowers blooming, you know, you can feel, you can see them blooming, you can see them opening, you can see them shining. So all these things influence our inner joy, and it just makes us cheerful. And you all know that when we are cheerful, when we are happy, then we work better. Our attitude towards life changes, we become more positive. And when we are more positive, we contribute in a better way. So somehow flowers, they just take our stress away. They are very good stress buster. And of course, they are mood enhancers. And these kind of studies have been done by the Department of Psychology, Rutgers University, as well as at La Salle University, Philadelphia. Now, another haiku here I would like to mention is Ikebana, a touch of pink to balance my blues. So Ikebana is a Japanese floral art where, you know, just one or two flower and two or three twigs are being used to create an arrangement. And just by creating Ikebana, it gives us a meditative feel. So we forget anything if negative is going on in our surrounding, or if there's any sorrowness or any pain, it does help to somehow cure it, or I would say it just helps us to live with it very easily. It eases out the pain. So Ikebana, a touch of pink to balance my blues. Beautiful haiku. So talking about health, it is influencing our emotional health. Then it is influencing better air quality. Then flowers are edible. Right, and there are many flowers which are having these edible properties. They look pleasing to the eyes. Like if you make a product out of it, they look different because there are so many colors and they are very bright. So if you add them in our food, it looks more appealing, looks more attractive. And the synthetic colors, they are, as you all know, that it is not good for health. Here, They're just not beautiful, or they're just not colorful, but they do affect our health. They have positive influence on our health, especially the pigments, natural pigments that flowers have. So utility could be in many ways. And talking about the tradition and culture, many flowers were being used in India as well as in other countries, like flowers of banana, of papaya, of this nyctanthus, then sesbania, rose, palash, mahua. These flowers have been traditionally being used as edible in many different ways. In China, flowers of chrysanthemum, prunus, hemerocallis, that is day lily, they have also been reported to be known. And in Thailand, antigonan, bougainvillea, clitoria, cosmos, they have been highly popular in the tradition of traditionally. Now talking about the reason for consumption, it could be novelty because it is giving a different color, it is giving a different look to your food. Then they are rich in antioxidant activity. Then nutritional values is also very good. Aroma and taste. Yeah, it is having different aroma. It is giving a different kind of flavor. So that also adds to the taste. And of course, decor. So how they are being used. This is a study being done in Portugal. And accordingly, it is more used in salads and in decor, decoration of dishes, in some jams, and also to aromatize the product. So talking about history, many different cultures have incorporated flowers into their traditional foods. So even in Roman culture, we would find rose and violets in cooking. Even in Chinese, Middle East, and Indian cultures. And during Victorian era, rose have been, you know, very much close to heart when it comes to not just beauty, but even for edible purpose. Then this daily, as they said, that is hemerocallis. Then this special blossoms, and even the carnation petals, as the French. These are the flowers which are highly rich in antioxidant activities. So hibiscus, geranium, marigold, tuberose, tabebia, these flowers. Even jasmine, cassia alata. Cassia alata is not a common, it is a bit uncommon ornamental plant, widely grows, you must have seen, and it is also highly rich in antioxidants activities. Then bougainvillea, even adenium, then nyctanthus. Then flowers rich in carotenoids. Carotenoids, again, they're very good for health. So cosmos, calendula, marigold, hibiscus. So such kind of recipes can be prepared utilizing these flowers. And flower tea is very soothing and very invigorating. You can utilize different flowers just to make tea and just sip it. Because when you are working continuously for hours and you feel like you need some kind of stimulant, and having tea, the regular tea is not so good. So instead of that, if you use hibiscus flowers or clitoria flowers or jasmine or chrysanthemum, such kind of tea, it adds to your health as well. Rich in flavonoids, rich in antioxidants, and it is very good. Now this is hibiscus subdariffa. It is highly nutritious flower, and it is very good. It can be utilized in many ways. Then this calendula, having antifungal, anti-inflammatory, and antibacterial properties. Directly the flower can be applied on the skin if there is any small wounding or ulcer, it can be applied. And even you can have it in salads, or you can just add it in pulao, or that way. Hibiscus is again very, very good flower when it comes to health, especially for women. It is having anti-inflammatory effect, improves blood circulation, and it is known to improve even hemoglobin level. So you can have this herbal tea out of hibiscus, and adding a pinch, adding some one or two drops of lemon gives a beautiful color. You can have it as hot, or you can have it as a cold beverage. So it controls even the acidity problems as per Ayurveda. And it helps to overcome the mood swings and mental weakness. So especially even for people who are aging. So for them also it is very good. Then marigold, as I said, it has that a little bit spicy and citrusy taste and a strong flavor. And which will make you more happy, because when you smell that marigold, it gives, it just strikes up, it gives some kind of beautiful feel. It makes you a bit relaxed. So you can have it in salad, or you can have it as a tea. And very good for skin related problems and even for eyesight. And of course, it has free radical. It can help in removing free radicals, so highly antioxidant rich. Then this nasturtium, the annual flowers, nasturtium is, they are again very good, and they can be utilized in different ways in salads or tea, again highly rich in antioxidants, and they are known to have herbal remedy for UTI problems. Rose is a wonderful flower, and it has many, many uses. Madam Jyoti and Vidushi ma'am will be speaking on this, so I'm not going to talk much on this, but it is the most loved flower in all traditions, in all cultures, and it is a wonderful flower even for health benefits. So in anti-inflammation, it's good for cold and cough problems, even for nervous system, and of course, even for skin. Then even jasmine flowers, they're also very good, especially for blood pressure. You can use them as salads and even as a tea. Very good for insomnia problems. So our food should be our medicine, and our medicine should be our food. So when we are having food, we should see that it has to add to our health. It should not have any ill effect, but it should make our health better. So here I would just add one few lines which I wrote on this this Gulmohar, Telonix regia. I sprout, I blossom, I wither away. I smile on the futility of life, and I merge with the cosmos. So, you know, just seeing flowers, you can learn a lot. It teaches us a lot. In most difficult situations, like if you see this lily, zephyr lily, you know, in monsoon, they just sprout up. You won't notice them at all, but as soon as the rain comes, and they just sprout up and they blossom. And the flower, the plant, seeing it looks so happy, so joyful. So this is about life. Like when the time comes, you get the environment, you have to blossom, you have to be cheerful, you have to be joyful. And as time ages, as the time goes on, like everything has its own timeline. So finally, we have to merge with the cosmos. So if you observe flower, it teaches you all, teaches us a lot. So thank you.
Workshop on roses. Dr. Jyoti Marwa, Director of Masuri Fragrance and Flavor Institute and High Altitude Wellness Center with Medicinal and Aromatic Plants, is a PhD from University of Mumbai on essential oils and their uses since ancient times. She retired as HOD History of ICLE's Motilal Jhunjhunwala College, Vashi, followed by being appointed as principal of KLE College, Kalamboli, Navi Mumbai, affiliated to University of Mumbai. She has 45 published research papers in reputed journals of CSIR, CIMAP, and Essential Oil Association of India's International Journal. The Indian Perfumer, she has completed major research project for UGC and was a fellow with SAG. Dr. Marwa has a vast experience in aromatherapy and ancient Indian perfumery heritage. She is presently involved in developing various aromatherapy products from aromatic plants of high altitude Himalayan region. Further, she is involved in skilling the rural SHGs for better livelihood options, with value addition of medicinal and aromatic plants of Himalaya. This community enhancement work is being done with Masuri Forest Division of Uttarakhand Government. She has scripted a valuable book with Kakshan name DFO Mussoorie Forest Division on fragrance and flavors of the mystic Himalayas, decoding the aroma for human wellness, which has been sponsored by the National Commission of Himalaya Studies. We welcome this academician and the entrepreneur, Dr. Jyoti Marwa. I would like to introduce her co-worker, Dr. who is helping in today's webinar. Dr. Vidushi Sharma is an aspiring biotechnologist. She has got her master's from biotechnology from the University of Manchester. She has worked in plant biotechnology lab under the guidance of Dr. Anil Day. Her master thesis was focused on algal cultures. She has worked independently in lab for several months and developed lab skills, especially molecular biology techniques. Simultaneously, she worked on commercialization of life science, and her business project was focused on providing alternative solutions for androgenic alopecia. She did her bachelor's in biotechnology, chemistry, and zoology from Christ Deemed to be University, Bangalore, where she took up two research projects in chemistry and zoology, respectively. Vidushi did internship at reputed institutions such as Durga Femto Lab, Bangalore, and the Unicom Pharmaceuticals Limited, Ghaziabad, during the course of education. We welcome our both the speakers to start their skill development program.
Recorded. Thank you for the message. No problem. Anyway, this was destined to be, so it has happened. But hopefully now we can go ahead without any glitches. So I begin once again with the topic that we are covering today, the goodness of roses and the healthy flavonoids and the health that human beings can derive from the consumption or use of roses. Okay. No, it's not moving. We move on to the next understanding of what we are coming up with. Is how these flowers are, or this plant is basically a healing flower, because nature has given us a number of plants which have been very valuably covered by Dr. Singh, Dr. Alka Singh. But we find that these healing agents which we have in these plants, they are also curative, they are uplifting, and they do a lot of human good in innumerable ways. Specifically now coming down to roses, which is one such example, which is when you take the plant in its completeness, in its entirety, you will find that the leaves, the roses, the stems, the stalks, the roots, the seeds, each of them has a contribution in human health and well-being. Firstly, we understand that roses are edible. They can be used as food supplements because they are giving a whole range of minerals and vitamins, and above all, what do we get is fibers, which is very much necessary for our wellness. You can create a range of skincare products, be it moisturizers, facial mists, soaps, bubble jellies, or aromatherapy oils. You can create a hair care range, which can be shampoos, conditioners, and a whole range of oils also for your wellness. And above all, they are mood enhancers. They can be used as mouth fresheners or teas and beverages. There are a number of, you can say, species of roses, which amounts to about 300. And there are tens and thousands of cultivars. They form a group of plants that are perennial. That is, once you have a rose plant, You can have it with you for a number of years to come without really going in for fresh sowing. Mm-hmm. You can find them as erect shrubs. You can find them as climbers, or they can be trailing stems, which are, of course, each one of them will have sharp thorns and prickles. But the greatest asset with rose is that it is to be found in any and every part of the country. And that's the availability of the rose, which, as Dr. Singh also said, that we normally look at a rose or we normally look at a flower and we say, what a beautiful flower, what a beautiful color, what a beautiful fragrance. But we are looking at the roses now from its goodness in its entirety. And therefore, finding roses throughout the country, in every part of the country, can be any cultivar, can be any species, it can be used in a gainful way. What do they do? What do these roses do? They regulate our cellular activity. We know that we are a whole lot of cells put together. And if this activity gets reduced in some way or the other, or it's compromised and there are toxins in the body, you will find that it's difficult for the body to overcome the stresses which are arising out of it. So they help to fight the free radicals. And therefore, they are relieving us from the oxidative stress. They are helping the body to function more effectively. They are protecting us from the daily toxins and stressors which are generated, could be for different reasons, due to external environmental pollutants or due to internal problems which are arising from compromised immunity. Roses have played an important role since time immemorial. They can be used, or they are used, to express feelings of love, compassion, concern. So going beyond the fragrance, going beyond the touch, and going beyond the sight, what does it do? It builds tender and soft emotions of togetherness in difficult times. It soothes out distraught and disturbed mental levels of fatigue and distress. It has a special significance in everyday life, and as well as on very, very special occasions, could be marriages, or could be festivals, or could be religious offerings and prayers. And since the past, since ancient times, they have been used to a large extent to what is known as aromatic waters, what you would call as gulab jal, etc. These are poured and offered to the gods and the goddesses. Look at the word gulab. What does G stand for? It's so interesting. Look at G. G is standing for a desire to go and to get things happen. U is standing for uniqueness that puts things together in a spotlight. And L signals an ethical attitude for logical thinking and just not sentimental impulses. Ab o hawa. Ab is the embrace of its exuberance. So look at the words that follow. Gul dasta, gul zar, gul shan, gul nisar, gulab jamun, something that is edible, gul badan, gul istan, gul bag, gul bahar. So look at the word gul as such in its entirety. It gives you the entire meaning of the word gulab. These are some Damask roses, which are very highly aromatic hybrid. And it is said to have come to all of us that we use it today. Look at the excellent sculptured variety, so beautiful. Look at the number of petals it has. It is said to have come from Turkey. If you look at this particular rose, look at the number of petals. Look at this particular rose, which is a wild variety, which is known as the Himalayan musk rose. It's extremely fragrant. And this variety is used, I have been using it for many, many ways in making gulab jal, or making various mists and tonics for the spray, for the skin, for the face, and for toners. And each one is contributing in a different way. Could be a variety which is so heavily loaded with petals, or could be a variety which has just 5 petals. And normally wild varieties are known to have 5 petals. So these are our collections which we have been working with. And this is, we begin with our understanding as to how do we get a gulab jal, how do we really extract a gulab jal. And there have been traditional practices in extracting this gulab jal, which is now, as you can see, we are putting in a deg or a container, which is normally referred to in our traditional, way or use of word, we call it as a deg. Now this is ready to be distilled. Once we have put it in a deg or a container, it is ready to be distilled. And what do we need? We just need flowers, we need a deg or a container, and we need water. So the three things are ready for extraction of our gulab jal. This is water being added to the flowers in the deg. And this is what today we call as hydrodistillation. So since ancient times, we have been using a deg bhapka basically for extraction purposes. And this continues to be called as what in scientific terms we would call as hydrodistillation. So what do the roses contain? The roses contain phenolic compounds, flavonoids, carotenoids, and natural antioxidants that are present in all parts of the rose plant. Be it the flower, as I just told you, the fruit, the leaf, the stem, the roots, the bark, and the seeds. The role of edible roses in human health is well documented either through traditional practices, and it has been researched and documented beautifully as a potent source of antioxidant compounds. This, after I finish, Vidushi is going to delve deeper into an understanding of these antioxidant compounds found in a rose. Our demos are going to be ranging from a wide variety of some of these goods which we normally use in our daily life. We could even do frosted edible roses, which Vidushi is going to be bringing forward to you. There will be a little demonstration on a home distillation unit. And there will be, if since we lost out on time, we could have done an animation video on distillation. We'll do some demos on gummies, on gulkand, on beverages and tea, and making of a face wash and a lip balm with roses. And also a demo on serum, if time permits, and a demo on tincture, at least to tell you as to what are the benefits of these demos in terms of making a serum and using it in a particular way, or a tincture and using it in a particular way. Gulab jal is acquired. Quickly, we go through an understanding. How do you get the gulab jal? You get the gulab jal and you use it as a gulab jal, or usko hum rose ka pani bhi bol sakte hain, as post distillation. After post distillation, you get another gulab water, which you can term as the gulab herbal water. And this also has its uses. I will be showing that to you also when I'm doing my demos. We begin with the making of a quick understanding before we really show you all these things. It's just to show you what you may use for making gulkand. You just need the rose petals and you need sugar, or you need honey, or you can go in for ways by which you are simply putting the two things together and allowing it to evaporate. The water from the rose petals is going to just simply evaporate, and the rose petals will merge with the sugar or the honey content that you have added to it. You can make beverages, which you can see here. I have done it with rose hips. You can see rose hips are nothing but the seeds which remain after the flower has fallen off, and they are a potent source of, you could say, nourishment to our body. And in fact, these rose hips are being used as a food supplement today. So you can pulverize these rose hips and convert them into a powder and then use them in your smoothies, and they are a potent source of vitamin C as well as fatty acids. So you find, and that's omega 3, 6 and 9, you find all three of them in the rose hips. Now the two rose hips that I have shown you in this particular slide is Rosa rubiginosa, which you know. And the smaller ones are Rosa brunoni, which we are finding in the Himalayan country. So if you can see on the right, I have taken apples and I have taken rose hips, and I have cooked them with a little sugar. You can do it with honey, and you get a fantastic rosehip apple juice. You can always also convert this into a jelly. So you can put roses in water and you can have your rose tea. And this is how, if you can see the darker version of the beverage which is placed before you, that is made with the rose herbal water. And the one which is on the right side is made with the rose, what you could say is extract, which you are getting after cooking your apples and your rose hips. But very, very nourishing drink, and you can go ahead with making this very simple.
One more time. 12:19. You can have early lunch. Rajma.
Interesting here, you can see the gummies and the jellies which have been made with roses. You can see I have also used roses and chamomile also. And you have the top image is of rose and chamomile gummies. The right hand image is of a rose gummy. And the left hand image is of a rose jelly. Now we are going to show you a demo also on rose face wash. I'm just giving an idea as to what does this contain. Look at just the three things which have been placed before you. Oats, which have been ground. Honey and rose petals, which have also been ground. And just a mix of these three things is going to give you a fantastic rose face wash, which you can keep on a regular use. There is no restriction that you have to use it once a week or once in 10 days. It's something which you can apply. It's nourishing. You can apply it on a daily basis rather than using a soap to wash your face. And it also works as a face pack. So you'll find a feeling of freshness and rejuvenation once you have used a natural rose face wash. This is a lip balm, which I'm also going to show you. And look at the three things that we are using. In fact, two things that we are using is shea butter and Vaseline. And obviously, we are going to go in for a use of rose petals, which have been ground and they have with a little rose water. And then they have been sieved to get the rose extract, which thereafter is added to this formulation, which is using shea butter and Vaseline. Now you can create a rose serum, and the serum is obtained by putting rose petals in oil, and the oil can be an oil of your choice or an oil that suits you, and your rose petals put in to give you a serum. Rose tincture is created in water. You can put your rose petals in distilled water, and you can get a tincture and see the number of uses that you can make out of it. You can heal your wounds, your cuts, or if there's an inflamed skin, there is an acne problem, there are heat eruptions, you can cool down the skin. It reduces dryness because it works as a humectant once, but particularly when you're using it with honey, and it soothes the itchy skin. Now, rose tincture and serum, I've just told you, these are images of the tincture and the serum that we have created. And in fact, it's a wonderful experience to go ahead with this presentation. So I will stop here. And I'll quickly hand over the floor to Vidushi to go into the chemistry and understanding of the wellness that is generated with roses.
Good afternoon, everyone. So first, I would like to take this opportunity to thank everyone, IWSA's Society, and Vigyan Prasad and Dr. Jyoti Marma for giving me this opportunity to deliver a talk on roses and titanoids in a pair with the flavor of love. Okay, so before we dive into the topic, we all know that roses can be found everywhere around us. And being in a tropical country, we are lucky to have a lot of them. So roses have been used in medicines since time immemorial. And there are different parts of rose extracts which show different antifungal and antibacterial properties. So rose petals and rose hips are rich in various vitamins, as well as folic acid, potassium, calcium, iron, tannins, and a wide range of enzymes. And roses are antidepressant and antispasmodic, estrogen. They increase bile production, which helps in cleansing, as well as they are cleaning agents and antibacterial, as well as antiseptic in nature. Roses have been used in traditional medicine for alleviating menstrual problems and treating blood circulation related problems. They also help in lowering our blood pressure, cholesterol. Next slide, please. Anti-inflammatory properties make them a wonderful treatment for sore throats and ulcers, as well since they're antibacterial, so they can be used as antiseptic for cleaning wounds. and they can stimulate the liver and increase appetite and circulation. And the extract of rose petals is used as an eye drop or an eye wash in case we have burning sensation in the eyes. And the creams from such a
Agarbatti deo na yaar bahut acha rahi hai te.
Is it possible? Can I share my slides? And if other participants can be muted for the while I'm giving the talk. If it's possible, ma'am, I'll just share it. So the creams which are made from this extract have been used for treating dry skin and conditions like eczema. And moving forward, next slide, please. Ma'am, I can't share it. They are sharing. So there are chloroplasts and first we'll talk about the different type of plasmids like chromoplasts and leucoplasts. So chromoplasts are plastids which contain our pigmented products and give color to our rose petals or different parts of the plants. And leucoplasts are colorless plastids. So why chromoplasts are of interest is because most of the antioxidant pigments and are present in the chromoplasts. And that's why we are discussing about it right now. And that most of our antioxidants are secondary metabolites, which means that they are the result of secondary metabolic pathways of plants, and they're stored and produced in the chromoplasts. Next slide, please. So from all the 30 medicinal plants which are rich in antioxidants, they have found that roses are second highest antioxidant levels, and they are rich source of phenolic compounds like phenolic acids, flavonoids, anthocyanins, and carotenoids. These polyphenols are secondary metabolites, and they're important for the functioning of plants as well as play an important role when animals or humans consume them as a part of their diet. So these are the structure of the major antioxidant compounds which are found in roses. So flavonoids and anthocyanins have similar structures. That's because anthocyanin is a type of flavonoid, and it's a very important flavonoid when you see it from a commercial point of view as well as health point of view. And carotenoids have a long chain kind of a structure which is like 40 carbon chains flanked by aromatic rings which might have oxygen groups attached to it. And moving forward, we'll talk about flavonoids and other antioxidant compounds in detail. So what are flavonoids? There are a large group of phenyl propanoids, and they include anthocyanins, flavanols like camphorol and quercetin, flavon and flavin-3-ol. We'll be discussing anthocyanin in more detail, but the another one which is very important is flavanols. They are co-pigments to anthocyanins, and they are pale yellow to colorless compounds, and they can absorb UV lights and thus protect the petals from drying or burning, and they attract pollinating insects. And their antioxidant property is due to chelating metal as well as free radical scavenging. They help to regulate cellular activity and fight off free radicals because they help fight as the oxidative stress on the body, and they control blood pressure and help in prevention of cardiovascular diseases. They're also known to, there's been studies which show that certain flavonoids help to lower the risk of type 2 diabetes when consumed regularly in the diet. And they have anti-inflammatory and antiseptic properties. And certain flavonoids have shown to arrest cell division of tumor cells. That's why they're of great interest for researchers and biotechnologists for anti-cancer treatment and anti-cancer cell research. Moving forward. So quercetin, apigenin, and camphorol, they inhibit cytochrome P450, which is a type of an enzyme belonging to the subfamily of CYP1A, which is involved in the activation of carcinogens like polycyclic aromatics and heterocyclic amines. So what our flavonoids do is they inhibit such enzymes, thereby inhibiting the progression of cancer further. So we don't know the exact quantities which will be required to arrest the cancer growth, but the research is being done in the area, and moving forward, we might see alternative medicines in the field of science and medicine. Then quercetin and other flavonons are known to inhibit the growth of Halobacter pylori as well, which is the organism which causes stomach ulcers. And they're also selectively inhibit the proliferation of viruses like poliovirus and herpes simplex viruses. And moving forward into anthocyanins. So as we know, there are type of flavonoids. The three major types which are found in roses are cyanidin, pelargonidin, and peonidin. So they impart the pinkish to reddish hues to our petals, and they're not only present in flowers and roses as such, they're also present in other fruits and vegetables where we see red and pink color. So this is the compound which actually gives the color to our petals and flowers and fruits. And the color, it depends on the pH of the soil. And since it's water soluble, so once you're fractionalizing and, you know, taking out the compounds and seeing, you'll get to know, like, this would be in the water soluble range. So we'll know, you know, when we are formulating our compounds, where it will be. Can you go back to the previous slide, please? Yeah. So it's mainly present in flowers and plants and fruits, which have vibrant colors and attract pollinators and therefore helps in reproduction. Next slide, please. So they play an important role in prevention of cardiovascular diseases as well as diabetes. And they show anti-cancer and anti-inflammatory activities. And anthocyanins are also known to show antimicrobial, anti-obesity, anti-diabetic, anti-cancer effects, as well as prevention of cardiovascular diseases. It's known to prevent edema. Edema is basically when the fluid gets, accumulated in a part of your organ or body, and especially it happens in the legs and you can see swelling. So it actually helps to relieve that. Then you have antioxidant properties because it inhibits free radicals, and it prevents lipid peroxidation and are also important for the prevention of cancer. Moving forward, carotenoids. So the last type of antioxidants we are going to discuss is carotenoids. As I've told you, there are 40 carbon chain. So there are C40 tetraterpenoids, which are lipid soluble in nature. And it's a chain of carbons, which is flanked by aromatic rings. And it has antioxidant properties because it has a chain and the ring has, because it has benzene ring, so it would have, the bond can be broken and it can, you know, take up the singlet oxygens, which helps in to reduce the oxidative stress in the body. And it provides the yellow to orange hues to the plants. And the role in the plants would be, it has photoprotective functions during photosynthesis. It is light harvesting and prevention of photooxidative damage. Next slide, please. And they're a precursor for the biosynthesis of an acid, which is phytohormone aspecific acid, and it attracts pollinators. And I've already told you how it performs its antioxidant properties. Then we have, it has protective agent against coronary vascular disease because it causes oxidation of, which is caused by the oxidation of LDL. And it enhances functioning of immune system by enhancing T and B lymphocytes proliferative responses, stimulate effector T cell functions, and protects us from sunburns. That's why it's one of the agents which is found in creams and sunscreens, which is a rage these days because people are moving more towards natural products compared to chemical sunscreens. And it's shown to inhibit certain types of cancer and by enhancing macrophage, cytotoxic T cell, and natural killer T cell tumoricidal capacities. Moving forward. So this presentation would have been incomplete without mentioning a phenolic acid, which is also very important antioxidant found in roses, which is ellagic acid. It has anti-tumor, antioxidant, anti-mutagenic, antibacterial and antiviral properties, and it exists as a multimolecular ellagen tannins in combination with glucose xylose. And when we consume it as a part of diet, ellagic tannins are metabolized by gut microflora, and they enable sustained release of ellagic acid, which has medicinal properties. Moreover, why plants need this secondary metabolic metabolites is because, as we have discussed, they have a lot of medicinal properties like antibacterial, antifungal, antiviral. So plants use them as a defense mechanism against plant pathogens. And that's why they're producing it. But we as humans can also take benefit from their production of these antioxidants because we are clever in that way. We always take from nature, but we also have to give it back to nature by sharing our knowledge, by planting more trees and planting more plants and going back towards our alternative medicines And I hope this presentation was helpful. Now we'll be moving forward to demonstration parts. And I'll stop sharing the screen. And Gulkan. And so we came out with a different kind of frosting thing, which we have learned and reviving it. So what we do is we take an egg white and we beat it till you get the foam. So you have to beat it and you have to get the foam. And you have to add a bit of water to it. And if, you know, because some people have an issue with the smell. So for that, you can add a drop of rose extract or rose essential oil or any other oil or flavors you use in bakery. And then you take the brush and you have to put a thin layer of this coating on your rose petals as well as stamens. So you have to make sure you have to get in between the petals as well, because what it does, it helps preventing our flowers from rotting, because we can use them for months. And at least for 3 months, they'll preserve their color, their flavor, and they won't rot and they won't have any fungus or bacteria growing in them. And once you have finished covering all the petals, and you have to do it from the back as well. So you have to do it from all the sides. Then you take sugar. So we actually grind the sugar into a fine powder and then you put it on a plate. And then you have to dip it there. So for the demonstration purpose, I'm doing it really fast. I haven't covered the entire flour with the egg yolk or egg albumin. So this is how it will look like. You know, it will have a bit of frost. And then you have to cover it from all the sides, from the back as well. You have to pour sugar. And then you can leave it to dry for 2 to 3 days in a shaded area. You don't have to put them in the sun, because then they'll lose their color. And they'll preserve their flavor and they're really tasty. And we have some from a really old batch with us. So this was our 5 months old. So this is how they are looking now. And then you can eat them. They're really tasty. And I'm sorry you cannot have it there, but once you make it, you'll obviously enjoy it. So I'll just taste it on your behalf. They're crunchy, crispy, and they still have their flavor. And it's similar to gulkan, and you can use any flower. It doesn't have to be roses. You can use other edible flowers like St. John's wort, calendulas, and just make sure, using a Google lens, that it's not toxic and you can have it. It's edible. That's it. Thank you. And that's my time. That's my cue. And now we'll be moving forward with the demonstrations, which will be done by Jyoti ma'am.
Okay. We'll go ahead now with a demo, a quick demo. It won't take time. But we are going to show you how actually gulab jal has been assured earlier. The date bhapka to you. So now this child is a youngster from BA first year, who is a member of our self-help group. And she will show how we are distilling date bhapka. We are taking date bhapka, which is a traditional method that probably the Beds and the Chikitsak people in the past used to use it to take out the ark. And this date bhapka is going to be explained by her, which I will tell you how you can do it at home, because everybody will not possess this kind of a date bhapka at home. Now, this was belonging to a person who was a healer. And when I had gone to Lucknow to a utensil shop, I found this lying there. And I was told that since the healer had expired, his date bhapka, which he had used to make medicine for the people, has come here for sale. So I quickly bought it back. This was about 20 years back in time. But understanding this, how Rinki explains to you the technique, I am going to tell you how we are going to be using at home a pressure cooker to take out gulab jal. So quickly over to Rinki, and Rinki is going to do it very quickly, fast, please, and go ahead to explain.
ये है डेग, ये है भपका. हम इसमें अपना गुलाब जल निकालते हैं. इस डेग में हम फूल और पानी भरते हैं और इस भपके को हम इसके ऊपर रखते हैं. इसके बाद हम अपना गैस ऑन करते हैं और पानी गर्म करते हैं। हम ये काम इस हीटर में भी कर सकते हैं। पानी गर्म होने पर जब पानी गर्म हो जाता है तो पानी उबलकर गुलाब के तत्व लेकर स्टीम बनता है और वो भपका के इस डोम पर जाकर लड़ता है। इस पर ये होने के बाद जब स्टीम ऊपर उठती है तो हम ऊपर से ठंडा पानी डालते हैं, वो भाप गुलाब जल बनकर इस नली से नीचे गिरता है और भपका को ठंडा करने के लिए हम ऊपर से पानी डालते हैं जो कि इस नली से बाहर गिरता रहता है। भपका सब हमें समझ आता है कि हमारा गुलाब जल है वो भाप से निकलता है और भपका भाप को ठंडा करने का काम करता है। थैंक यू।
एक्सक्यूज मी बेटा, दिखाना आपने गुलाब के फूल किधर डाले थे, वो दिखा दो।
इसके अंदर हम गुलाब और पानी डालते।
थैंक यू।
सो इट वॉज अ वेरी सिंपल एक्सप्लेनेशन गिवन बाय अ यंगस्टर हु हैज बीन लर्निंग दिस for the last 1.5 years working with a self-help group. Now, just to tell you that we have these self-help groups of women, which we have made in the Mussoorie Forest Division range. And the Mussoorie Division has been doing that. And these are in the rural areas of the Mussoorie range. These women spend half their lives in the forest areas. And the purpose of these SHGs is to show them livelihood avenues so that the forests are, because they have been using the forest for many reasons, because of which you have issues of wood logging or you have issues of forest fire. So it is showing them a way to make a livelihood option for themselves by learning these crafts so that the forests are not harmed by them in the coming times or in the future times. So this was to tell you about what these SHGs are. Now quickly, I think I'll tell you how the same principle of a dek bhapka we can use at home. You take your pressure cooker and don't put the whistle on top of it. Instead of that, you just use a tube and connect it to a container where you're going to collect your gulab jal. Put your roses in the pressure cooker. And once you heat the roses in the same principle like she showed the dek to you, and thereafter, you will have the cooling process which is necessary for condensation. So you will put the container which is going to collect your gulab jal in a water bath. So any vessel which is having cold water in it, you put your collecting vessel in that. And once the steam will arise, it will go through the tube and go into the container where you're collecting and cool down because of the water bath, and you will get your gulab jal. So it's such a simple technique. You can do it at home and everybody can do it at home. Now we go on to the other demos that have been scheduled for you today. And each of these demos now will be of a different understanding. And therefore, first I'll begin by telling you what is a gulab jal and how do you use it. Now this, I have weighed out this gulab jal, which is about 100 grams. A little gulab jal I have added in the spray bottle, which works as a mist, so I can spray it on my face, particularly when it is very cool, very hot and very warm in the plains. You can just spray this on your face in this manner and you will have the gulab jal all over your face to cool your skin and to give you any kind of relief for any kind of a itchy sensation. Now this I have weighed into 100 grams, and the first demo that I'm going to give you is that of a gummy. How do you make a gummy? Now, I don't know if everybody understands what is a gummy. So I'll quickly explain. We are used to what is called as a candy. In a candy, we normally, what we do, we will take sugar, put water, and hum wo ek tar aur do tar ki chini bana lenge. Uska ark hum jo bana lete hai, uske saath hum candies banate the. Now, these are gummies, which we are making on a very different line. And they are nutritive. So they are giving nutrition to us. So I'm using the gulab jal. So whatever Vidushi told you as far as the benefits of roses are concerned, this gulab jal I'm using. And I'm using one more ingredient, which is called agar agar powder. okay, or it can be substituted by something which we can call, which is called as guar powder. So the difference between the two is, this is very expensive, this is lower in range, this is totally vegetarian, so for the people who are vegans, they can go for this. And this, when we are talking of agar agar powder, it is extremely expensive, but it is made from algae. So that's the difference in the two things. But both the things are going to do the same thing, that they are going to help us to make our gummies. Now, what do we do in this? We just take our rose water, pour it into a utensil. Now, I'm not going to take time to heat it and show it to you, but you pour the 100 ml of rose water in a container. And to this, we are going to add, you can take either of the two, but I am taking agar agar powder here, which is about one level spoon. It's got to be level, not too much. And I will add it to my gulab gel. Once I've added it to my gulab gel, I will simply mix it and allow it to bloom for about 10 minutes. So you have to set it aside after you have mixed it for about 10 minutes and allowing the agar agar powder to bloom in the rose water. All right. Now, once I have kept it aside for 10 minutes, thereafter, when my powder has bloomed in the water, I am going to add nothing else to it but a simple solution here that I have made. If you can have a look at it. Can you see the color? It's red. And this is made from rose petal extract. To this, if you want more color, you need not put any synthetic colors to it. You can take plums or things which have a red color in them and add it to your rose water so that your extract, rose petal extract. And this I have procured or managed to get by taking the petals, grinding them in my mixie, putting a little rose water to it and a little distilled water added to it. And then I have strained it and I have got my extract here, petal extract. And with this red color, I am going to get red color as well as a rose gummy. So to this, after my 10 minutes are over, let's presume here that we do not have time now. After I have cooked this after 10 minutes, probably you can take it on your gas. Don't make the gas flame too high. Keep it a little medium. Or then you can also just turn it off. So you can put it here on your plate. Cook it till it's, I haven't given it 10 minutes because we don't have time, but cook it till it gets hardened. The mixing completes. It's getting a little thicker, I can feel it. You can see it's thick, right? Now, once I've got this kind of a consistency in it, I am now going to add my solution here, which is of rose petals and honey in it. So I've added honey to this. I've kept it ready. And I'm just going to add, depending on how much I want, and I get the right consistency, I will add my solution to this, which will give me the my gummies a nice little pinkish color. You can see that. Now, once this is done, I have to just pour it into my mold. I'm using a mold here to give my gummies a little flowery shape. So I pour it into my mold here. And by the end of the session, you will see that the gummies are ready. You have to thereafter put it in the fridge to cool it for about 10 minutes and your gummies are going to be ready after this. And this is how you prepare a gummy, which takes no time. From here, I'll put it in the fridge, let it just cool down a little, thicken out a little, and then I'll put it in the fridge. And at the end of the session, you can see that the gummies are ready. From here, we move on to the next demo, which is going to be very interesting for young girls and for women. You can make your own lip balm, which is a very simple way. You are using nothing but just simply three ingredients. Sorry. Vaseline. Okay. Vaseline, rose extract, and shea butter. All right. Now, in this case, you since the shea butter, I have weighed out my shea butter. It's about 30 grams. And to this 30 grams of shea butter, I'm going to add half the quantity of Vaseline, which will be about 15 grams. And to this, I'm going to add my rose extract. Okay. And hereafter, you will get a lip balm. Now, this lip balm does not have the color that this one will give you, because this I have made with rose herbal powder. And this is, water. The rose herbal water gets this color. Okay. This also we have got through after distillation, but it remains in the pot. And the rose water or the gulab jal that we are talking about is the clear gulab jal which you are getting after your distillation, as wherein the steam has been condensed and you have acquired your gulab jal. So that there's a difference in the two colors, which will be this way when you're getting this reddish color, and the herbal water will have this color. So you can see the difference in the two waters. This is having, of course, honey, a little honey added to the water, which has been extracted from the rose petals. So we will get a lip balm hereafter, which is going to be like this. This is the Now this also I'm going to go ahead to show you how we are going to make this lip balm, which is a very simple way. I'm just going to put a double boiler. I have a double boiler, which is also called as milk cooker. I'm going to add my shea butter. Shea butter is hard. It hardens out, and therefore I need to melt it a little, and I'm going to melt it here in a boiler. And I think everybody has a milk cooker at home, so there should be no problem in trying to do this work. You just need to add the shea butter to your milk cooker. Once this is the Vaseline that I'm adding to the shea butter. Okay, now I'm going to put this on the flame once again to get it in a melted state. unfortunately, there's no light. The light has gone today. It all had to be today. But anyway, this is how you are going to melt this. And once you have melted your shea butter and the Vaseline, you simply have to add your rose extract to it. And thereafter, put it in a container. You add about 3 to 4 spoons of your petal extract, rose petal extract. And thereafter, put it in a mold to get your, pour this out into a mold and put it in the fridge for about an hour or so, and you will get your lip balm in this form. It's going to be like this. So this was the making of a lip balm. And hereafter now, we are going on to the next, that is making of a face wash, which is equally very, very interesting. Because when you do have skin problems which are related to acne or basically to any kind of a reddening on the skin or sunburns or any kind of a hormonal issues which leads to blemishes on the facial skin, you need things which are going to be more caring for the skin. So when you're taking a rose, depending on what you have just heard Vidushi telling about the benefits of understanding what rose petals do to us in general, we look at it, its important role in skincare. And therefore, we are now looking at making of a very, very simple thing at home. And its use can be, you can keep it away for 15 days, use it for 15 days, make a fresh batch after 15 days and keep using it, keep it in your closet and keep using it on a regular basis. This also needs just simply 3 things: oats, honey, and rose petals. Here, these rose petals are not extracts. These rose petals are only fresh petals which we have dried. And then we have just ground it in our mixie. Just pulverize it a little and keep it thickish. You need not make it very fine powder. You can keep it a little thickish and keep these 3 things ready with you. When you need to make a face wash, a ready face wash, you can just take any kind of a container and make the face wash in this manner. If you can have a look at this, I'll show you the face wash here. Okay, this is a little which I have made to show you. You don't need any heating in this. So you get this face wash. And what does the honey do? It works as a humectant. So it is going to be moisturizing your skin. So we will take a small amount of oats. To this, we will add honey. Two or three spoons. You can increase it the way you want because it's not going to be harming your skin. It's going to be beneficial, and mix it nicely. Working as a humectant, it is going to moisturize your skin. It's going to take the moisture from the air and keep replacing your skin with the required moisture. Now, once the oats and the honey have been ground, have been mixed together, to this, you're going to add your rose petals. Probably 1.5 spoon of this. If required, I can add a little more to it also. And it's such a simple and a natural way of using natural rose petals for the benefit of your skin. So this is the consistency of a, you can add, if you want, you like to do it, you can add 1 or 2 drops of rose essential oil, which is extremely expensive. So nobody would want to do that. It's nearly about, you can say essential oils are 8 lakhs to 10 lakhs a kg. Rose essential oil. Anyway, I am pouring 1 drop here. Of the essential oil. To my face wash. To make it more fragrant. Mix it up. And keep it in your vanity case. put it in a bottle, save it, store it, and keep it in your vanity case for your skin regimen. So with this, we have shown you three demos, and we have shown you how you can use your rose water in as a spray for your face or cooling your skin down. You can use rose serums. Now, this is a rose serum which has been made, and in any oil, I have used it in olive oil. You can make it in an oil that you like. This is a rose tincture. You can see the small Himalayan musk roses in this bottle at the end, which I have put in a hydrosol of rose. So I took a hydrosol or a gulab jal. If I use the word hydrosol, I mean the gulab jal. I have taken the gulab jal and I've added a few petals to it and I've left it in there. So I'm getting my rose tincture. With these three demos that I have shown you, we move on to the next. I'm going to show you Gulkand. Now, I told you about the Gulkand. It's a very simple way wherein you're making Gulkand with rose petals and you're using sugar or honey to give you the sweet flavor. If you look at these two rose petals in sugar, I have done it in sugar. This is also Gulkand. This is also a Gulkand. And this is also a Gulkand. All right. What is most fascinating about rose petals in sugar or honey is that you can make it the way you desire. Now, this has less sugar, if you see. It's quite loose. It doesn't have too much of sugar. This, you can term it as sweetened rose petals. And this has been designed to make your cakes and biscuits, etc., because it has less sugar. The petals are only sweetened. This has more sugar. If you see, it is hardly, you can find it almost, you could say it is settled in the sugar and it's a little hard in its movement. This is the real Gulkand. This is made this year. And what is most fascinating is, please see this. This is Gulkand 2012. I have made it in 2012. And believe me, you have to just put it in your mouth and see how it just melts. It's not spoiled. No preservative has been added to it. But see how the petals are working on their own. And the sugar. Of course, the sugar is contributory in preserving the petals there. But both the things when combined, look at the longevity in life that it gives to your Gulkand. So you can design your Gulkand the way you want for the purpose which you wanted. This has been designed for cakes and biscuits with less sugar. This has been designed to be eaten as a sweet meal and therefore it has more sugar. This has been made in 2000. I don't know. It may last me a lifetime. It may not get spoiled even till then. So this is what I wanted to show you about Gulkand. Such a simple technique it is of just taking rose petals and sugar or honey and making your Gulkand and a meal which children will relish at home. So we've seen how you can make gummies, and in the same way you can go into making candies. We've seen how to make skincare products which are very, very simple. Takes no time, probably 10 minutes. And you're done with a candy, with a gummy, you're done with a face wash and a lip balm. So you're not using all those harmful chemicals that are being poured into your skincare products or your food items. You are handling everything at your end and yet you are getting the best out of the roses. So I think with this, we will come to the end of our presentation today. And if there are any questions and answers, me and Vidushi are ready to answer them for you.
Thank you, Jyoti and Videshi. What an exhausting, session you both have given. But it was pleasure to see that how simple you have made it. Things are so simple that each woman in the house can prepare these.